And that verse that all things work together for good, the question is, how does God define good? It may be a little different than how I define good.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive. That is author and speaker, well-known psychologist, Dr. Larry Crabb. He spends a lot of time thinking about those deeper questions about suffering and pain and what we endure in this life. Dr. Crabb was our guest last time on Focus on the Family. He's back with us again today, and your host is Focus President and author Jim Daly.
John, what a powerful conversation last time with Dr. Crabb, as he helped us to think about some critical questions about God and suffering. Is God good when he allows pain in our lives? And why does he allow those who love him to go through such difficult things in this life? Larry has thought about these things for a long time, and he's battled with cancer, he's lost his brother in a plane crash, he's seen friends and family go through various trials. But through it all, he continues to learn that God is a loving God, and he is present in times of trouble. And he really does want the best for us.
Dr. Crabb is going to talk today about some of the inspiration for his book, When God's Ways Make No Sense, which of course we have here at Focus on the Family. He'll address the Bible story of Jonah and then contrast that with Habakkuk, a man who trusted God in spite of some very difficult circumstances. With that, let's go ahead and resume the conversation with Dr. Larry Crabb on today's episode of Focus on the Family.
Larry, in the book, you talk about Habakkuk.
Yeah, several pronunciations.
Many ways to say that. What's the lesson from that biblical story?
You know, the whole theme of the book that got me writing it was Jonah. God comes to Jonah, and after he had come to Jonah earlier and saying, I want, as my prophet, I want you to tell Israel that they're in for good times. And that made Jonah a very popular prophet.
Sure.
And then when Israel now is doing very well, they only have one problem left, and that's Assyria, the capital of which is Nineveh, a murderous nation. And God comes to Jonah and says, give them a chance to repent. I don't want to destroy them. That made no sense to Jonah. Aren't you committed to your people, to making life go well for your people? I want you to destroy Nineveh. So God, I'm going to resist you. I'm going to run away from you. I'm going to resign my role as prophet. The dickens with this ministry of following you. Resist and run was Jonah. And that got me thinking about, when God's ways make no sense, do I tend to resist and run? And then you have Saul before he became Paul, not King Saul, but Paul before he met Jesus. And as Saul, he was trained by Gamaliel, the leading Pharisee of the day, a brilliant man, obviously, as a younger man, very brilliant, studied the Old Testament. And what did he come up with? He didn't come up with the gospel. He didn't read Isaiah 53 correctly. He didn't see that the offerings of Leviticus were all about the Jesus person who had already been around, and he distorted the message of the Bible in the Old Testament to fit his predilections, to fit his own culture, to fit his own prejudices, and he denied the parts of the scripture that contradicted his worldview. When God made no sense to him by saying that there's going to be a Messiah who's going to suffer, and it's going to be extended to the Gentiles. And Paul says, you got to be kidding me. Messiahs don't suffer, and the Jews are your people. What's your problem, God? So he distorted the truth of God and denied it. But then Habakkuk, he was prophet at a very difficult time in Judah, and he saw all the sin, and he came to God, and he said, God, you're confusing me. Why aren't you doing more about this mess? I mean, I feel that way when I watch the news. God, why aren't you doing more about this mess? You're this almighty God. And one of my favorite verses, Colossians 1:11, where I want you to know, Paul says, I want you to be strengthened by the almighty power of God, which will strengthen you to endure and be patient. And my thought is, no, I want the almighty power of God to change my life so I can be happy all the time.
Right.
He says, no, to endure and be patient. Well, he came to Habakkuk, and Habakkuk was saying, God, you're making no sense. Why aren't you straightening out your sinful people? And God says, well, here's my plan. I'm going to use Babylon to destroy Judah. And Habakkuk said, now you're making me more confused than ever. This is not a good idea, God. But what did Habakkuk do when God's ways made no sense? And this is the theme of the whole book, really. What did Habakkuk do when God's ways made no sense? He didn't resist and run. He didn't say, I'm done with you, God, which some Christians do. Recently, I've met a number of people who become atheists, who formerly were declaring themselves to be believers. And there, because God has been so disappointing, I can't believe there's a good God if he allows all this stuff. But Habakkuk didn't resist and run. He didn't distort the gospel and find some way to make it more comfortable. He closed his mouth after reminding himself of what he knew about the character of God. I know you don't put up with sin, and I know you're faithful to your promises. And because I believe in the core message of what I know about you, God, I'm going to sit in your presence and wait to learn from you. And when Habakkuk heard God make it very clear, a more sinful nation than Judah, Babylon, is going to destroy Judah, Habakkuk's response in the last chapter, it's the best part of the entire book. Without this last part, I wouldn't like the book at all. I trembled in the presence of what God is doing that didn't fit my agenda for my smaller story. But I trusted that even if everything goes wrong, there's no more cattle, there's no more crops, everything is taken from my life, I will trust that you know what you're doing and a larger story is being told that is coming from your good heart, and I can trust your good heart even as I tremble. And that to me is the what got me to write this book. When God's ways make no sense, can I tremble when the doctor says you have cancer? Can I tremble when years ago my son said my wife is leaving me? Can I tremble when my brother was killed in an airplane crash? Can I tremble when God has, from my smaller story perspective, let me down so often? Can I tremble but trust that, no, there's a larger story, and it's unfolding right now? It's so hard to get your mind around this because I want my smaller story to work.
And I want my smaller story to be the bigger story.
Exactly.
That's really
it. Why don't you cooperate with my agenda?
In fact, Dr. Crabb, in Christian culture today, how do we most often twist theology to meet our needs? Give us some practical handles here. What are the greatest mistakes that we make in the Christian community when we twist theology to bend toward our comfort and leisure?
I think our culture has mastered that art, that we really have twisted theology. And I suppose one of the major twists is that what God sees as our worst problem is very different than what I see as my worst problem. What I see as my worst problem is the struggle of life, the suffering of life, the pain in life. God sees my worst problem to be my self-centered spirit of entitlement, that everything is supposed to revolve around me. And in a marriage, for example, that I've been married now for 51 years, and there are times my wife misses my cue as to what she's supposed to do for me.
That is frustrating.
It is frustrating. And I pray for my wife along that line that she might begin to understand that this marriage is all about me, for goodness sakes.
Guilty.
Why doesn't she go away and get this? Yes, exactly. But when I understand that our theology can easily be twisted into the attitude that God's glory is secondary to my pleasure. God's glory is secondary to my fulfillment, as opposed to realizing when I live for God's glory, that becomes my joy, that becomes my fulfillment. Now, that is a very, very hard sell, and it's a twisting that we have done on a rather routine basis. And I think we can find the Bible to support whatever twist we want to support. I've often thought about Deuteronomy 29:9, where God says through Moses, if you carefully keep the terms of this covenant, everything you do will prosper. I read that and I go, I'm going to keep the terms of this covenant. I'll have devotions every morning. I'll never miss church. I'll witness to my neighbor. I'll tithe. I'll do all these good things. Now, God, are we clear? I've done my part. Your turn.
Right.
Now, that's twisted theology. Mm-hmm. And the reason that verse is true, but we've twisted it, nobody carefully keeps the terms of this covenant. The whole point of the covenant was to expose the fact that we need a savior, not a helper to get it right so life works.
Right.
That's the twisted theology in its major form. But the other twist that I think that has come into our culture, which has gotten a little more mystical with the movement of spiritual direction, which I'm very supportive of, I think we've come to believe that the Christian life is supposed to be nothing more than a deep experience of God's presence 24/7. And if that's the case, I'm missing out. Do I experience his presence? Yes. 24/7? No. So what sustains me more in my journey to follow Christ is not my experience of God, it's my thirst for God. As the deer pants after the water brook, so my heart pants after you, O Lord. And do I realize that God really is my greatest good? The Trinity is a very happy community, and they've invited me into the dance of their relationship. And when I understand that God is my greatest good, then perhaps I'll be able to realize that demanding that God cooperate with my agenda for my life, that I feel what I want to feel at every moment, that really isn't the point. It's a thirst for God until I get to heaven, where it will be 24/7, if in a timeless eternity there's such a thing as 24/7, I'm not sure.
Larry, I've got to ask you right at the end here, maybe tens of thousands of people who are listening, they're living in that bad place, in that place of despair.
Yes.
They've had horrible things happen to them, and they've got their fist waving in the face of God. And my first point would be, God can take that.
Yes.
Come at him.
No, he still
doesn't
loves him.
Mind that.
No, he loves him.
But what advice beyond that do you have for that wounded person who doesn't see God's bigger story? They're living in their smaller story of misery right now, maybe understandably. What can they do to say, okay, Lord, I'm going to trust you, I'm going to tremble? How do they get moving in that direction emotionally, spiritually?
Here's where my mind very quickly goes to the word church. And when I use the word church, I'm not thinking centrally of the Sunday morning sermon, as vital as that is, and as legitimate and as powerful as God ordained that sermon, Sunday sermon is. But I'm suggesting that the person who's living in profound darkness and living in despair, until they're able to, number one, as I said earlier, embrace all of that, pretend about nothing, and somebody might say, that's what I'm doing. How do I get beyond embracing all the darkness in my soul and the despair that I feel? I don't know if there's anything more powerful for a person in that situation than being able to find someone whose soul is quiet, whose soul knows what it means to trust God in the middle of agony, and to share their story with that person. My favorite existential psychiatrist, not a believer, a man named Irvin Yalom, says the greatest tragedy he's experienced in all his years of psychiatry, he calls it the tragedy of an unobserved life. And when I'm in my darkest moments, I have a couple of people. One is my wife, but I think it's important to go beyond. And I have a guy that knows me at my worst, knows me at my deepest struggles. And here's what can initiate the change. Here's where the momentum can develop into a right direction, the tremble and trust. Am I willing to look as bad as I really might be in despair, maybe in anger, maybe seeing my fist, maybe feeling my darkness, maybe wondering if this Christianity thing is even worth looking at? Can I be who I am with a profound authenticity in the presence of somebody who still delights in me? Because that's a picture of the gospel. I call it looking bad in the presence of love. When you have a relationship with someone who can provide that, you're on your way to finding the narrow road that leads to the abundant life of becoming like Jesus for the glory of God and for your own joy.
Well, and here's the tough question. I appreciate that, and I think that's absolutely it, and it fills the two greatest commandments you talked about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
But are we training within the body of Christ? Are we training one another to have that kind of attitude? Are we falling short there? Back to Paul's example where you mentioned he pursued the wrong things because he truly didn't know the Word of God. Are we missing that in some ways today when we don't have a sense of peace that God's in control no matter what the election outcome is, no matter what is happening? My point is obvious. I think we're missing it at times, that we're feeding our flesh rather than our spirit with some of the attitudes that we foster within each other, that we don't feel the freedom to be vulnerable with a friend because we feel we could be judged. And therefore, we don't have authenticity within the church.
Do we have another hour?
Yeah.
Because I think that one of the greatest sadnesses and the burdens of my own ministry is to see community develop in a way that is very rare in the Christian world, in Christian community, in the church. I fear that we put on our personas, mm-hmm. And even last Sunday, as I preached in a very fine church with the leadership of the church, I'm very taken with, a good friend of mine as a pastor. And I don't want to sound this as negative as it might, but so often in churches we say at the beginning of it, now greet one another and say hello to each other. And that's nothing's wrong with doing that. But we don't meet each other. How you doing? Fine. Just had a fight with my wife, but I don't want to tell you about that.
Right.
And can we acknowledge that nothing's wrong with some congeniality? Nice to meet you. How are you today? I'm not opposed to that, of course. But can the church from the pulpit, can the person behind the pulpit acknowledge, not acknowledging every sordid, miserable thing in his soul, but can he be authentic from the pulpit? And can he let people know that I struggle in a way that Jesus has met me there, and I would like each of you in the church that I pastor to be aware that at your deepest struggle, there's a way that the Lord can meet you, but it's going to happen most powerfully in community. I preached on this last Sunday, and a lot of people were responding very favorably. One man came to me, and he said rather angrily, he said, "I never tell people about the struggles I have." And I said, "You're making a very big mistake, sir." He said, "I am not," and walked off. It wasn't one of my happier moments after
sounds
a sermon.
Sounds like a pleasure to be with.
No, that wasn't exactly the case.
What was he struggling with?
I think we're missing.
What's that attitude? I mean, where's that coming from?
Sheer pride. It's sheer pride. It's a question of I want to look good as opposed to be who I am. And is the church missing it to some degree? I don't want to be a church basher because I'm not. But I sure do believe that would be very, very good if we recognized in our church structure how easy it is to nourish and reinforce an entitlement attitude that says it's God's job to keep my soul blessed. And when, you know, if my next book sells a whole lot and I make a lot of money, and then I say to somebody, "Isn't God good?" I hope they slap me in the face.
Right.
I hope they say, "If your book sold 2 copies, would he still be good? And if you went broke and had to declare bankruptcy, would he still be good?" Well, no, that isn't my theology. Then I have a bad theology.
Correct.
And so I want people to understand that the church is not there to make everything go well in life. The church is there to help me become the husband, the dad, the wife, the mother, the friend, the whatever, the grandparent in my case. I want to be the kind of grandparent that knows the Lord in a way that arouses my children's thirst for God.
Larry, that is so good and so right. You know, I'm thinking of the encounter with Jesus and Pontius Pilate, where there was a bit of discussion about the mission of Jesus. You know, and Jesus said, "I came to testify to the truth."
Yes.
And we started at this place where you mentioned the healthy person is a person who knows the truth.
Yes.
That is living in the moment of that truth. And isn't that a great challenge for all of us, to be honest with God? Don't be what you want to be. Don't be who you wish to be. Just be who you are and let Jesus start there.
And that's how the book of Job ends, after everything he went through. And it wasn't just suffering. It was unexplained suffering. All he knew was life doesn't make sense at all. But at the end of it, look at chapter 42. And God said a sentence that my father pointed out to me that I wouldn't have seen otherwise. He's talking to his bad spiritual directors. And he says, "My servant Job has spoken truthfully." Well, Job was, you know, saying a lot of hard things.
Right.
But he was being authentic about where he was in the middle of it. Right. And God said, "You're my man. I'm doing good work in you, pal." And that's what God wants to do in me.
God honors that. Dr. Crabb, this has been fantastic. Great things to think about, profound things to think about. And trusting God, no matter what the circumstances are. I've tried to do that in my life, as an orphan kid, trying to say my circumstances don't dictate my joy. It's my relationship in Christ that makes all the difference.
And the mistake we made, we say we trust God, and I always say, for what?
Yeah.
Am I trusting God for all the second things, which he may or may not give me? When he does, rejoice, praise the Lord. I got all kinds of blessings in my life. I like them, and I'm grateful for them.
Always say rejoice.
Yes, always rejoice. But I want to trust the Lord for what he's up to in my soul.
Dr. Larry Crabb, in a conversation recorded in Charlotte, North Carolina some time ago. After our interview, we fielded some questions from the audience. We had some friends gathered together to watch the event. And here's one of those questions now.
Hi, I'm Dave Osterhus. And Dr. Crabb, I'm curious, do you think a lot of what we struggle with as it relates to God's plan versus ours relates back to the conditioning we've had in school and in the workplace? And what I mean by that is we spend so much of our lives identifying problems, coming up with a solution, and then working either individually or as a team towards a result. And so whether that's happened in school or in the workplace, there's usually a reward that's attached to that. So do you think part of our issue with challenging God, I guess is the way to put it, is just because of how we've been conditioned in that way?
I think how we've been conditioned has shaped what we came into the world with. And let me explain what I mean by that. I was sitting in South Africa with a man named David Broughton Knox, who was considered at that time to be the finest theological mind alive. He was a brilliant man, principal of a major theological school in Sydney. And he and I had a chance for a long conversation and to sit together for a time. And I said to him, Dr. Knox, let me just ask you a very simple question to ask, but I don't know the answer. I'm a psychologist. I've talked to people with all the struggles. I look in the mirror, I see struggles. What's wrong with people? What's our problem? What's wrong? And I was waiting for a two-hour lecture from a brilliant theologian. He paused about 2 seconds, and he said, self-centeredness, and stopped. And I thought, what are you talking about? And that shifted my entire perspective. David said that in Sin Did My Mother Conceive Me. He's not talking about the sin of intercourse between husband and wife. He's talking about the sin nature that is in each of us. So I think we come into the world with this entitlement spirit, with this, it's all about me, and God owes me whatever I want. And then I think your point is very well taken, that the work environment, the school environment, basically nourishes that self-centered attitude that basically says, my greatest good has nothing to do with God's person. It has everything to do, if I'm a Christian, with God's provision. Not provision for my sin problem, but provision for my struggles with life. And so prayer then becomes negotiation as opposed to surrender. Mm-hmm. And we live as entitled selves, not surrendered souls. And I think that that's very much encouraged in school and certainly in the workplace. And when I got my graduate degree in psychology, the mood was, now go out and knock them dead. Get your practice. Market this way. Get people to come see you. Larry, you might have some talent here. You're going to have a successful practice. And then when I began speaking, and I enjoyed speaking, and people said, let me invite you to do more speaking, my thought was, I think I'm getting it together now. And God wasn't the center at all. And that was phase three that we talked about with Jim a little earlier. Phase three was, I led the blessed life. Everything was going fine, and I was encouraged to believe that that was the whole point of existence. And it wasn't until I got a little more years under me that I thought that isn't the point of existence. So I think your point is well taken, that we really are nourishing without intending to, and sometimes in church as well, not just school and work. And that's very sad to say. We're encouraging the mood we come into the world with, that basically it's all about me, and what defines my value is some form of success. And that cannot define my value.
There's an example I'll give quickly. The 21 men that were beheaded in Libya, do you remember that, by ISIS? That night I was driving home from the office in Colorado Springs, and I remember in the news clip they said the men had gone to raise money to send home so the families could be in proper housing. So we have an office in Cairo. I don't know if you know that. For those of us that support the ministry, you help support an office in Cairo. And Sammy Yaqub is our man there, doing wonderful work in the Middle East. We're doing abstinence education in Muslim schools with Christian trainers. Think of that. And anyway, I called Sammy the next morning and said, find out how much it would cost to finish the homes. And it was $247,000. Fastest fundraising. I think it took 15 minutes. Five phone calls to raise that money. And we did it. And it took about a year to complete the homes. And I was talking to Sammy, and I was kind of in my Western MBA mode, accounting for the dollars. Tell me what has been spent. Has it all been accounted for? And Sammy says, well, Jim, the families are weeping. And I said, Sammy, of course they're weeping. He said, no, Jim, they're weeping with joy that they were found worthy to suffer for the name of Christ through the loss of their loved one. And I thought how contrary that is to at least for me, kind of the Western thought of winning, victory, zero-sum game, we win, you lose. And there they were in tears, weeping with joy that they were counted worthy to suffer for the name of Christ. Those are our brothers and sisters in the Middle East. And it just, for me, it's a challenge to live in this pleasant culture with all its rewards and try to hold on to a faith like that.
And to maintain the balance, that it's a wonderful thing to raise a couple $100,000 to get some homes going.
Oh, yeah.
And we want to do the good thing. Social justice has a place. But it can't be first.
Right.
And that is the difficulty. And I certainly don't want to argue with anybody that how wrong of you to be successful in your business. I'm not saying that at all.
Oh, yeah.
But
it's
certainly
the balance of everything.
But the balance of everything, that cannot be your identity. It cannot be your purpose. And Lord, in his kindness, sometimes shatters our dreams in order for us to discover what our deepest dream really is.
Dr. Larry Crabb talking with Focus President Jim Daly and me and some friends who had gathered for a recording in Charlotte, North Carolina.
What a good visit we had with Dr. Crabb. And I love his reminder about the two things that are most important in life, and that is to love God and to love others. And that really sums up the teachings of Jesus as well. I said before, this is a hard subject, but Larry has really helped us today, and I hope you'll get a copy of his book.
Request a copy of When God's Ways Make No Sense when you call us here. Our number is 800, the letter A and the word family, 800-232-6459. Or stop by our website where we have the book, opportunities to donate, and other resources at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast. And today, if you can, please make a gift to support the work of Focus on the Family, and we'll send a copy of that book to you as our way of saying thanks for joining the support team here. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.